Okay, so a perfectly legitimate question at this stage is, why have we spent so much time factoring? And to begin answering that question, we're going to show you how to solve equations using factoring, and then we'll go ahead and do an application after that to sort of motivate for things for factoring for you. If we need to start off with a logical observation, note that if somebody tells you that A times B, so you're multiplying two things together and you get zero. Well, what would you conclude about either A or B? Well, clearly you'd be thinking that either A was equal to zero, that's one possibility, or B was equal to zero. One of those two things had to be true, right? Now, these two statements we say in math are logically equivalent. And what we mean by that is this, that if A times B is zero, then either A is 0 or B is 0 or both of those. And it also goes the other way. If either A is 0 or B is 0, then you know that A times B must be 0. Okay, now a couple of things about this. First of all, you see how this right-hand side has to be 0? That has to be true. If it's 1 or 5 or negative 2 or something other than 0, then you can't use this logic, okay? And the second thing is this, that the left-hand side has to be a multiplied by b. If it was a plus b or a minus b, then all bets are off and this won't work as well. So that is why we care so much about factoring, because factoring means that you're going to get the left-hand side here to be a product, that is a times b. Okay, let's see an example of how this works. Let's say we were asked to solve, and let's say that we had 2x squared plus x is equal to 6. Okay, so we have to put our equation into this form right here. So the first thing you have to do is get 0 on the right-hand side. Let's write that down. First thing, you have to get the right-hand side of the equation, so the right-hand side equal to 0. Okay? So that means that we're going to subtract 6 from both sides. So we get 2x squared plus x minus 6 is equal to 0. Okay, so then what you have to do, once you have 0 on the right-hand side, then you have to make sure the left-hand side is a product. Okay? Now that means you have to factor this left-hand side. Now we've spent a lot of time on factoring, and we'd factor this one by using what's called the AC method, if you recall. And if you need to go back now and review that video, go ahead and do that because we're really going to need some strength with factoring. And you want to make sure that problems like this, factoring this is becoming sort of, or not taking too much time at this stage. So when you factor this, you're going to get, let's see, well, the right-hand side is still equal to 0. You're going to get 2x here and x there. And you're going to get a positive 2 here and a negative 3 there. Okay? Okay, now we basically have this equation right here, a times b. Then what you do is you draw the conclusion that either a equals 0 or b equals 0. So all of this is a, and all of that is b. So this is a times b equals 0. And what that means is either a equals 0. So 2x minus 3 equals 0, that's one option, or b, x plus 2 equals 0, okay? Now, you have to solve these little equations that we created. So the way we solve this one is we add 3 to both sides, and we get 2x is equal to 3. So from this equation, we get x is 3 halves. And from this equation, we subtract 2, and we get x is equal to negative 2. Okay? Now either one of these is a solution, either 3 halves or negative 2. And what's important to note is that the form that we had to get, right? We had to get 0 on the right-hand side, and the left-hand side has to be a product. Okay? And once you have that, then you proceed as I did in this example. Let's try another one like that. Okay, let's solve. Negative y to the fourth plus 10y squared minus 9 is equal to 0. Okay, so first of all, the right-hand side is equal to 0, which is the first thing we want. Once you have that, you want to factor the left-hand side. Now, whenever the lead coefficient is a negative, we factor that out. So out comes the negative. Let's try that again. Out comes the negative, and we get negative y to the fourth minus 10y squared plus 9 is equal to 0. That just makes factoring a little bit easier. So the way we factor what's in parentheses is, well, it's going to be, in this case, y squared minus 9 times y squared minus 1, and then equals 0 still. Now, you want to set these factors equal to 0. This is like a negative 1 here, right? Now, it turns out that whenever you have a constant, like negative 1 or 3 or whatever it is, a constant does not affect your answer. So the constant does not affect the answer. So once you have this situation, 0 on the right-hand side and the left-hand side is a product, you can basically ignore any constant that's a factor. But what you do, of course, have to do is keep on factoring, right? In this case, y squared minus 9 is y plus 3, y minus 3, and this is y plus 1 times y minus 1. So it's negative y plus 3 times y minus 3, and then the y squared minus 1 is y plus 1 times y minus 1 equals 0. So you always want to factor as far as you can. And now we can ignore the constant, and well, when y plus 3 is 0, we get negative 3. When y minus 3 equals 0, we get positive 3. For the next one, it's going to be negative 1. And then for the last one, when y minus 1 equals 0, we get a positive 1. So in this case, we have four solutions. Now, notice that the polynomial equation that we are solving was of degree 4, right? So it was a fourth degree polynomial. And we ended up getting four solutions. Now, it turns out that that's not always going to be the case, but you'll never get more solutions than the degree of your polynomial. So the degree of your polynomial sort of gives you the maximum number of solutions that you can possibly get when you solve the equation. Okay, that result is called the fundamental theorem of algebra, or that's one conclusion you can draw from the fundamental theorem of algebra. Okay, let's try another one and maybe see an application how we can put this to work now to give us some motivation for factoring. Okay, so the height in feet of a ball at t seconds is given by this function. H at t is negative 16 t squared plus 48 t. And the question is this: when is the ball at a height of 32 feet? So remember, the left-hand side always represents the height. So I'm going to replace that left-hand side with 32. So the equation becomes this. 32, let's try that again. Make it look like a 3. Okay, so it's going to be 32 equals negative 16 t squared plus 48 t. Now, we're going to solve this in the same way we solved our previous problems. Let's first get the right-hand side to be 0. So if I add 16 t squared and subtract 48 t from both sides and leave the 32 where it is, I get 16 t squared minus 48 t plus 32 is equal to 0. Okay, let's now go ahead and factor this. First, we'll factor out a 16, the GCF. So we have 16 times t squared minus 3t, plus 2 is equal to 0. And now we can keep factoring, right? So we're going to get 16 times t minus 2 times t minus 1 is equal to 0. Okay, so remember, a constant does not affect your answer. So when we set this equal to 0, we get t is equal to 2. And when we set that equal to 0, we get t is equal to 1. Now remember, these represent times, and so we should write in seconds. Okay, and these would be our answers. The ball when the ball is after 2 seconds or after 1 second, the ball's at 32 feet, but the ball's again at 32 feet after 2 seconds. So why don't we take a moment and just analyze what this problem is even talking about? Let's go ahead and see what this represents on another page. So here we have the height of our ball, negative 16 t squared plus 48 t. Okay, so what's basically happening? Well, you, let's say, are sitting there and you are taking a ball and you're throwing it up into the air. So here's your ball and you're tossing your ball up into the air. Okay, and the ball reaches some maximum height way up here. Okay, now let's say that this right here is 32 feet. That little line represents 32 feet. What happened to your ball? Well, it went up and it crossed 32 feet. It kept going higher, but it after 1 second it was at 32 feet, and then it reached its maximum height. And then what happened? Well, it started falling back down, and it crossed 32 feet again on the way back down, and then it landed back in your hand, let's say. So the ball was at 32 feet twice, once on the way up and once on the way down. Now it turns out that this function right here, the graph of this, you see how it's quadratic, it's raised to the second power? The graph is what we call in mathematics a parabola. And a parabola kind of looks like a U. It's not quite a U, but it looks a little bit like a U. Do you see how it's negative right here? The lead coefficient is negative. That means the parabola opens downwards. So it turns out, and we'll go ahead and see how to graph parabolas a little bit later, but it turns out that this parabola happens to go through this point right here and also this point right there. Okay? Now, before I talk more about some other points, what is this point? Well, it's saying the time is zero and the height is zero. That kind of makes sense, right? After all, if your hand right here marks 0 feet, right, then the ball is starting off when the time is zero, the ball starting off at 0 feet. And what happens after 3 seconds? Well, at 3 seconds, the ball is back in your hand, okay? So the ball's at 0 feet in the beginning and at the end, 3 seconds later. Now, when is the ball at 32 feet? Well, what we just found in the previous problem is that the ball, after 1 second, the ball's at 32 feet. Okay? When else? Also, after 2 seconds, the ball's at 32 feet. And when you get more and more points, what you're going to find is that the parabola is going to look like this. I'm drawing just a bunch of points here dotted so you can get an idea of what this parabola looks like. So it keeps going like this, and so on. Okay, so do you see that kind of U shape? It's sort of like a downward opening U, if you will. It's not really a U, but it kind of looks a little bit like one. Now, in math, of course, the U would keep going. It'd keep going down like this, and it'd keep going down like that. Now, of course, we are talking math right now, but we're also talking an application of math, that is physics, right? And what's happening is, in physics, of course, we don't keep extending the parabola downwards because it doesn't represent our physical situation. The ball doesn't go below 0 feet. Like, for example, this would be like negative 1 foot and negative 2 feet. And because the ball doesn't fall below our hand, it doesn't get any lower than zero. Okay? So we wouldn't extend the parabola in this physical situation. And also, you might say, of course, that, I wouldn't go this way as well, right? I wouldn't let the time be negative. Because generally speaking, the time starts when we throw it. So the time is always, zero or greater. In this case, the time stops at 3 because the ball lands, and that's the end of the motion of the ball. Okay, so hopefully, seeing how to solve equations using factoring gives you a little bit of motivation for why we spent so much time factoring. And we'll see more of parabolas a little bit later. Okay, until next time.